All right, welcome back to the Dr. Jimbo Love Show featuring Patrick the Picker and Seth Matthew, who are both are not here today. As you can see over my shoulder here, the brother sign broke this morning as well. They went to turn it on and it shorted out. So we don't have our brothers in the background. But I just want to remind everybody we are at Brothers Bar and Grill at the Shops in Northfield in Denver, Colorado. For those of you that are in the Denver metro area, come on up. We're just north of I-70 in the Shops of Northfield, which is the Harkin Theater and Bass Pro Outlet. Everybody knows where that is. Last Man Standing, a show that was on for a number of years with Tim the Tool Man. And they did a show, and it was based on that Bass Pro Shop that's right over here. We share a parking lot with it. So, anyways, we're going to do a little different thing today. Instead of going through and talking about the NBA and the NHL, although I'm going to give you quick updates, and everybody knows that the Heat are up 2-0 in their series. They ended up winning 2 games in Boston. Boston's kind of got their backs to the wall a little bit. We'll be heading down to Miami. They just can't seem to figure out Jimmy Butler, and the Heat are just looking great right now. Of course, our hometown Nuggets are up 2-0 against LA. They played 2 games here in Denver and managed to win both of them. Although some of the stuff that we saw here in the fourth quarter was just absolutely amazing. Jamal Murray had just one of the most incredible fourth quarters I've seen in playoff history for a Nugget, of course. But they've won, and now they're going to be going back to L.A., so it'll be interesting to see what happens in L.A. There's a lot of talk, and what we're going to talk about today a little bit is the rigging of sports, whether you believe that some of the sports are being influenced by betting and the money involved with betting. I've got a couple different things that we'll talk about as far as just some ideas and concepts, but I'm going to just introduce it today. We're going to talk more about it next week when Patrick's here, and we'll talk further about the entire series. NHL series is up and running in the Eastern Conference champion. You have the Florida Panthers versus the Carolina Hurricanes. The Panthers won the first game, so they are up 1-0 in the series. Remember, it's a 7-game series, folks. The Dallas Stars ended up beating out the Kraken. They are playing against the Vegas Golden Knights. Golden Knights took the first game and it was 1-0. So, but anyways, let's talk a little bit about the fixed, and this is the first part of a number of series. We talk about betting a lot on the show. Now, is the betting affecting the shows the games at all? Is it affecting them in a sense? Is anything being manipulated behind the scenes that we don't know? And really, there'd have to be 3 aspects, but let's go in and let's delve into this real quick, and we'll talk about an article that I saw from the New York Post, and let's just pull it up here. There's a gentleman that wrote a book. His name is Brian Tuohy. It's T-U-O-H-A, Brian Tuohy. He has a book that's been out for a number of years now, but it's called The Fix Is In, The More Corrupt and Conspiracies That the Pro Leagues Don't Want You to Know About. So let's talk a little bit about what he's got here. And it starts way back with a series that was Cleveland versus Golden State back in 2016. It's been a number of years. But just to give you kind of an idea, the Golden State Warriors went up 3-1, and Cleveland, of course, we know, ended up winning that series. And this gentleman was so moved by how he felt the series was manipulated, he ended up writing a book. So let's read a little bit about what he's talking about here. He says here, we'll probably never know, but Tuohy's book chronicles a myriad of ways that the outcomes can be manipulated, either by players, the officials, or the leagues themselves. And those are the 3 areas that we're going to look at today. An author of the series books involving sports conspiracies, Tuohy's book is based on publicly available media reports his own interviews with athletes and sports figures, and the FBI files on bribery that go back decades. And now through the Freedom of Information Act, you can pull these and see exactly what the NBA was looking at. One of the biggest offenders, this gentleman claims, is the leagues themselves. Major League Baseball, National Basketball Association, and the NFL, and others have the power to nudge outcomes of the games if they choose to. The biggest takeaway I tried to impart is that it is not illegal for sports leagues to fix their own games. Let that sink in for a second, folks. It is not illegal for the actual leagues to manipulate games and change the outcomes. And for the reason is because there's been a law passed that these are considered forms of entertainment. So just like WWE, everybody knows that it's fixed. Although there are some people out there that think it's not fixed. It is a purely entertainment contest that's predetermined and scripted. Now, the NBA, NFL, and the baseball, Major League Baseball, I don't think that they're scripting games, but there's nothing that stopped them from nudging different things, and that could be by talking to officials, by talking to players, talking to coaches. Okay, and getting a desired outcome, if that's what they so desire. Now, is that fixing the games? It's what they call basically manipulation and massaging of the outcomes. So, he goes on and says, I don't think anyone is stopping them, he continues. The only thing that prevents them from doing it is their idea of integrity. But when you look at sports and you see criminals who are allowed to keep playing and use the performance-enhancing drugs, their integrity can be questioned. Tuitt admits that finding conclusive proof is very difficult. Now, we haven't really found a whole lot of this happening. I know there was an NBA official back in 2007, Tim Donahue, that basically was caught betting on games and then manipulating the outcomes to help his bets. Of course, he was banned from the league, and of course, it has been sweet. No one even talks about it anymore, mainly because it was such a black eye for the NBA. Evidence is that contestants have tampered with are all out there, involving most every major sport. There's a number of ways the thumb can be put on the scale. The easiest way, Tioi says, is via the referees. Most simply, they can be paid off, as an organized crime has tried to do in the past and influenced. There's many instances where they talk about times where this did occur. Let me just take a quick little break here and tell you that this beer right here is Station 26's Tangerine Cream. It's my go-to beer here at Brothers. And it's absolutely fantastic. If you get a chance, please go out and try to get some of this. You know you can get it here in Denver. And you can also go right over to the brewery, Station 26. It's an old firehouse. And get yourself some from the freshest of taps. So this is, they go on and they talk about Tim Donahue, who in 2007 pleaded guilty on betting games. He called and influencing the outcomes, as claimed that the league lets its officials know how games should be called. So he admitted that the league actually did allow him to do this, in a sense, and encourage him to do this. Blow the whistle more often on these plays, for example, or swallow the whistle when it comes to a star player. That's merely an employer telling employees how to do their job. Donahue told Sports Illustrated in 2016 that the NBA finals were prolonged on the league's orders. And back then, we had Draymond Green, who was suspended. And we also saw an instance where Stephen Curry, who had never fouled out, ends up fouling out of the game. And his wife actually goes out and tweets that she felt as though the game is fixed and being manipulated because of money. That tweet was out there. I don't know if she's recalled it back, but it is there. You can definitely go and do your research and find it. let's look and see what else. Now, that was from the New York Post, okay? So it's a pretty reliable source. It's a big, big newspaper out of New York City. You know, its distribution is close to what the Times is. So that was an interesting thing. Let's look at some of the other stuff that we've got here. And I'll just kind of read a little bit from what you got here. This is from a post in our sports book. You're seriously underestimating how much control the refs have over a game. You don't need everyone to be in on it to rig a game. For example, for overs and unders in the NBA, okay, each quarter you can call more soft fouls on both teams, get the teams into the bonus. This stops the clock and also ends up having more foul shots, which does drive up the scores. That's how to influence the over. For the unders, just don't call as many fouls and let them play. Call more charges instead of blocks. Call more travels and carries to disrupt the natural flow of the game and create more empty possessions. I always see people say that the refs are so inconsistent and the foul calls are some kind of, you know, they sometimes enforce the rules and sometimes they don't. And it depends on the player. Sometimes it's on the situation. You can even see that change from quarter to quarter. I mean, I'll give you an example. The game that we were watching, the Denver Nuggets game two, the first quarter was called just absolutely poorly. There were just so many fouls. You saw a lot of players complaining from both teams. And I thought to myself, oh boy, the fix is in. You know, here they are. The NBA wants the LA Lakers, so they're going to try to even up the series here and call a bunch of little terrible calls on the Nuggets. Well, it ended up being in the second part of the first quarter, the bad calls went against the Lakers as well. And what you see is a situation where the first quarter was just all over the map. Thank God, like I said in the opening, that the Nuggets ended up having such a strong fourth quarter that it just didn't matter. So that's one story. Let's go to another. This is a source from Quora. And what it says right here is kind of interesting. I thought, you know, they call gambling, that there's the gambling mafia out there. It's an underlying factor that can influence things. And maybe that's a little extreme. But, you know, they said here, just to be clear, they don't manipulate everything. Just 10 to 18% of each league's fixtures is sufficient to achieve their goal. There's lots of money to be made from targeting accumulated parlays and than single games for the bookmakers. And you can see how they do that. And some of these prescribed parlays, and then they'll advertise how many people actually bet it and make it seem like it's a good bet for you. But we don't know, you know, are they manipulating one of the legs? Is one of the legs set to be able to set so they can suck as many people in as possible for that bet? And then at the end up having you miss one of the legs, which has been, you know, fixed or manipulated or massaged, however you want to call it. And, you know, so this source goes on and says some teams take a dive and they move along. Ultimately, the players are known to have solid non-disclosure agreements. It's part of their signing. And everything is kept secret in the fact that the NDA, non-disclosure, even exists would be denied. Otherwise, good luck finding a team to play for. Now, that's kind of extreme, and that may even balance on a conspiracy theory. Refs are usually not kept in the loop, according to this source. Okay? Although there are some refs that have signed a similar non-disclosure agreement. Now, the reason I kind of draw away from this a little bit is because if there were actual non-disclosure agreements being signed out there, I think somebody would either be disgruntled or someone maybe got fired or something like that would come out and let us know. But that's something to look at in the future. You know, we're talking about billions of dollars here. Now try and observe the number of games you feel that have been manipulated or scripted, and you'd most likely be correct that they were, in fact, manipulated. Remember, again, remember, under the law, this is considered entertainment. So unless you are bribing someone to throw a game, changing the outcome of a game really ends up being part of the entertainment value, just like professional wrestling. So anyways, folks, what do you think? You know, I have mixed feelings of believing in this. I mean, sometimes I can sit there and I'll be watching a game and I'll see a bunch of different calls that look horrible. I've said it over the years that I thought that certain games may, especially in series, they may manipulate a game in such a way because you want more games played. They don't want to see a sweep. You know, you want to see a series go at least six games, more than five if you possibly can, and if you can get to a game seven, that's even bigger TV ratings for the last two games, especially the game seven. But, you know, it's something to think about out there. And what we're going to do next week is we're going to delve more into this. We're going to talk to Patrick a little bit. Patrick's a bettor. I mean, people that bet a lot, they definitely have the ability to be able to notice whether there are certain calls and stuff down the stretch. Of course, they've got a lot of skin in the game. So it'll be interesting to see what Patrick's take is on it. I'm definitely going to talk to Seth as well. You know, Seth watches a lot of sports, and even though he's not doing the show anymore, he still is a contributor, and I want to get his take on maybe a 10-minute little soliloquy, and he will tell us what he thinks and whether he's seen specific examples. Now, again, we don't want to sound like conspiracy theorists here, but there are billions and billions of dollars involved with this. So, if somebody can have an advantage, or if some league can have an advantage, and now with these betting apps being so big and expanding into so many other states, it's just a matter of time until the money just keeps building and building and building. So, we will be watching this closely over the next upcoming weeks. We'll do a second, third part series if necessary on this. And like I said, it'll be interesting to get the takes from my partners and see exactly what is out there. So, all right. Well, folks, I said I was going to do a pretty quick and concise show today. So that's just kind of watch your whistle, a little bit about gambling and sports and the fixing of sports. We'll get more into the playoffs for both NBA and the NHL next week. I mean, basically, you know, both championship series are just starting out from both the NHL and the NBA. So we should have a lot more, information regarding how things are playing out, and that we'll break down some of the games as well. Folks, we want to remind you to come on down here to Brothers Bar and Grill at the Shops of Northfield. This is the home of comfort food. You cannot get better comfort food, and I'm talking about food from all over, you know, United States, Midwest United States. Cheese curds, just fantastic. Gator balls. What is a gator ball? I mean, it's fantastic. It's a chicken ball that's wrapped in bacon with pepper jack cheese melted in the middle. It is fantastic. You cut it open, cut it into quarters, and you just absolutely let the cheese run over it, and it's fantastic. I don't even use it as an appetizer. I'll end up actually eating it as my meal. So come on down and check that out. The TVs are absolutely fantastic today. Remember, we have the Preakness that's going today. That takes off tonight at 5:01. So, you know, Mays is in there, the winner of the Kentucky Derby. That's the favorite. Mage. It's a 5-3 favorite right now. And there's some other horses running as well. Get a chance, come on down here and watch it. They'll have it on, they'll have the sound on. And also, too, folks, we're in the second major of the year for golf, the PGA Championship. It's being played in Rochester, New York. Bryson DeChambeau started out in round one at -3. And now we have Scottie Scheffler is at the top now after the halfway point. But round three will be kicked off a little round two. They had to kick it off this morning. They're going to run it through all day long. So if you're home, look at it on ESPN. If not, come on down here to Brothers and we'll put it up for you. All right. Well, folks, we want to thank you again for tuning in. I want to thank the people on LinkedIn. They've been absolutely fantastic. I want to thank some of my other contributors, Matt Johnson. He's our Gonzaga inside guy. He listens every week. He's always giving me great ideas. And he's one heck of a guy to work with. So thank you very much, Matt. Seth is great. Patrick, we miss you. Patrick's down in Albuquerque with his family, spending some time. He'll be doing a Preakness party down there. We'll try to get some information from him for next week's show. Hopefully he'll be here, which will be really nice. So in the meantime, folks, get out there, go to LinkedIn, go to Getter, go to all these other sites, YouTube, and look up the Dr. Jimbo Love Show. Share it with your friends. Let them know. Make comments, too. Let us know what we're doing right, what we're doing wrong. As you guys do, I love it. I read your comments every week, and I appreciate them very much. So, all right, folks, as we say every week, get out there, get your side hustle on, and earn it. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next week.